Kids can play with toys, they can also play in the financial markets. Today, we are joined by a mother who turned her young children into investment whiz kids with high financial quotient. Can you do the same thing? We'll find out. I'm Edric Mendoza. This is On the Money. Mary Rose Fres Fausto and her husband started training their three boys how to invest in the stock market the same time they were learning how to read and write. How did they do it? Everything's told in her best-selling book, Raising Pinoy Boys. Hi, Rose.
Hi, Edric. It's good to be here.
Thank you. And with me is a copy of that book, which I'm very eager to go through.
Oh, yeah.
So let's start off with the whole idea of why is it important to start children off early when it comes to dealing with money.
It is very important. I know you're a father of
four
wonderful children.
Three boys plus a girl, almost like you, but the plus.
Yes. Yeah. You may beat me by your bonus, your darling little girl.
That's right.
Anyway, I think all parents will agree with us that all we want is for our children to be happy, to have great lives. Mm. And we know that whatever path our children will take in the future, they will have to deal with money. Mm-hmm. No exception. And no matter how successful they become in the other aspects of their lives,
right.
But if their financial affairs are in a mess, they will actually lead very stressful lives. And that's the life that we want for our children. And why is it important to teach them right now when they're still very young? It's better before they start developing bad money habits.
Yeah.
Right?
Makes a lot of sense.
It's really important to be creating your childhood money memories, because I'm telling you, this will be the very foundation of how they will relate with money in their adult life.
Childhood money memories. I like that phrase, huh?
Yes.
To help build childhood money memories. So let's go into the discussion of these money matters, if you will. The word we use today is FQ, financial quotient. Can you help define that
well,
in layman's terms?
We're adding again to the many Qs that parents
have to
contend with. You have IQ, intelligence quotient. You have emotional
EQ,
quotient, adversity quotient.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? I read the blog of your wife.
Okay.
I think she introduced SQ because that was the first time I encountered spiritual.
I should read my wife's blog more often.
So it's SQ. So now we're dealing with
FQ,
and it has to do with the way you manage personal finance.
I see.
Okay, so you don't really have to be a math genius.
Okay.
And in fact, being
That's good to clarify, huh? You
don't
have to be a math genius, okay? Like you or your husband, no?
Yeah,
okay.
I don't claim to be one. And in fact, being a math genius is no, it's not a sure.
Guarantee also.
Yeah, it's not a guarantee of having a high FQ.
Sure.
All you need to know are the four basic operations of mathematics.
Of course.
Addition,
yeah, we don't have to go through that. Yeah. Okay. So take that FQ definition, and now how do you apply it to children?
Apply to children.
Right.
Well, first of all, you have to be the best role models.
Role model.
You cannot teach what you don't know.
You cannot teach what you don't apply yourself.
If you're talking about values, a way of life, it is more caught than taught.
Agree. Wow. Diba? Well said.
So you really have to be a good model.
Right.
When it comes to dealing with money.
Yeah. Save your money, then everywhere you go, you're spending. I mean, how will your child connect that? Great. So role models.
Mm-hmm. So you talk about them. Mm-hmm. You know, it has to be discussed among family members. Over dinner, we would talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it so happens that since my husband and I were
in
the finance industry before I became a full-time mother.
Yeah, the best profession. I like to say that.
We would be discussing about stock investments, where best to put your money. So more or less they were exposed to that at a very early age.
I can imagine.
Yes.
A lot of exposure.
You know, there's one thing. You might say, because you guys know that. So how about the parents who are not
investment bankers or finance people?
Well, what I can say to that is that knowing how to deal with your money should be everybody's business. Everybody.
Sure.
Whether you're an artist, a politician, whatever, a teacher.
Right.
And I think it's the same basic tools. So it's an attitude of always saving. I'm just lucky that I grew up in an Ilocano household.
Nako, Ilocano. Ilocano kamat. I mean,
Anyway, so I grew up with a mom who was very frugal.
I can imagine. Oh, wow. I see shades of my own relatives. Oh, my God.
However, this is something that I'd like to share with the televiewers and with you.
Yeah.
My mom raised us saying that live within your means, mm-hmm. but enjoy the fruits of your labor. Mm-hmm. So I think I even liken it to a mm-hmm. diet. So mm-hmm. if you're always diet, kawawa ka naman, you're not enjoying anymore some, you know, dessert or whatever you're craving for, it's hard to sustain.
Sure.
So make it something fun.
Okay. That makes sense. I mean, all work and no play, I mean, so to speak, right?
Yeah. And
wonderful.
Then you try to make it systematic. Okay. Like, for instance, the boys. They started receiving their weekly allowance when they were in grade one. Mm-hmm. So we had a rather, we had a system. Mm-hmm. First, I would give them their allowance mm-hmm. at the start of the week. Mm-hmm. And then we suggested to them at least 20% should go directly to savings
already.
So they set it
so
aside.
Rose, I'll segue a little bit and say, how early do you want to start off with children?
How early?
So you said it's a grade one. So that's about 6 or 7 years old.
You know,
so is that the earliest?
You can go even earlier.
Like
whenever,
what?
Whenever I'm asked that question during the talks that I would give to parents, I would say, when do you start? Because I really consider it as a financial literacy journey.
Correct. Makes sense.
So it's a way of life. You start as soon as they're born.
As soon as they're born,
okay, you open.
Example, I want to imagine that. So you have a six-month-old baby. What do you do?
You don't teach your infant
the money.
Of course, What I just meant with that was that you open a savings account for your child, mm-hmm. and then that's where you deposit the cash gifts that mm-hmm. they will receive from their baptism, mm-hmm. birthday, mm-hmm.
Christmas, all of those.
Can you imagine how many occasions there would be before he starts asking
about
money? There's
a lot in our culture, diba?
Diba? And if you have very generous ninongs and ninangs, you can actually put some in longer and higher yielding financial instruments.
So you start setting that up for them, and then when they're of the right age to understand,
that's when you can start. Now that's when you implement the system. That's what we did. Okay. They had this treasury box, which was actually given by a promo of savings bank of a bank.
Okay.
And then they would put their allowance there.
Yeah.
And then whenever it reaches like 1,000 pesos, they would already deposit that in the bank, in their ATM account.
Okay.
But we also tell them that your ATM account doesn't really earn interest, so you shouldn't put a lot of money there.
Okay.
So if your deposits go way beyond the minimum balance, you should put it somewhere else. And we gave them two options, higher fixed income instruments and the stock market.
Okay. That early, already
that
you're
early.
Giving them that option.
Yes.
All right.
So how do you tell them what the heck is stock market?
Exactly. So tell us about stocks. Well, how do you brief your children?
Or even some adults now who are...
some adults might be able to relate to that as well. Parang stocks 101.
Yes. Investing in the stock market is just being a kasosyo, if I may say, of the successful entrepreneurs that we have.
Larger corporations. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. If you want to be the kasosyo of the Ayalas,
okay.
Henry C.
Jollibee's.
Yeah, Jollibee. So, and for kids, it's better to look for companies that they can easily understand. And of course, Jollibee is our favorite because
they like
every Filipino child loves Jollibee.
My kids, one of the first symbols they recognize, Jollibee.
Jollibee. Okay. In fact, my sons, they all had their pet names for Jollibee.
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway,
so things like that, no? Things that they can remember easily would be the stocks you mm-hmm. want to introduce to them.
And it really gives them the thrill when they see the stock certificate under their names.
Really?
And then there's the mascot, the picture of the mascot there.
Now, you can get that under their name even if they're not 18 yet?
So, for example, what's the name of your
Elijah.
Oldest?
It's my elder.
So it's going to be Edric Mendoza in Trust 4.
I see.
Okay.
Okay. So I can do that for my son.
Yeah, you can do that.
That's good learning.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's right.
So stocks, tell me about, we're figuring out how to apply this FQ. You've now talked about stocks. Can you give me other examples or strategies you have used in helping mm-hmm. your children embrace FQ early on?
Well,
you have a lot of stories. So I think our viewers would appreciate hearing all these examples.
Let me just tell this nice story that I remember about my youngest. He was still very young in grade school. So he already had some money in the stock market.
Fixed
income. So, okay. And then one day he said, Ma, I think I'd like to transfer almost all my money into the stock
market. How old was he at this point?
Probably
early grade school.
Yeah, grade school. I can't remember how old exactly. And then I said, but Anton, don't you think that's quite risky? Because, you know, we show them how the prices fluctuate.
Yeah.
And this was his answer. He said, but don't you and Daddy always say that in the long run, the stock market gives us better returns, better income?
He really remembers
those conversations. Yeah, he said that. Okay. And then he said, he went on, he said, if my stocks, the value of my stocks go down, my lifestyle will not change. It's when your stocks go down that my lifestyle will change.
That's clever. He still knows that mom and dad are there. So he has a higher, he can make more risks, in other words.
Yeah, he has a very high FQ. He was actually able to articulate.
He could relate those two, no?
Yeah, he was able to articulate that. Kids, actually, and this is why I actually advocate all parents to put their children's money in longer-term investments, because children are supposed to be our dependents at this point in time. So we should be fending for their needs, and they have a longer holding period, a higher risk appetite, so to speak.
Because they know that they have a buffer
at that point.
Tell me about how do you break down the jargon to your children?
You know, you cannot underestimate how kids are intelligent. So intelligent, you know, they're always exposed to television, internet. Right. So you just try to explain it to them.
Using, I guess, words that they can understand.
Words that they can understand. For example, in their ATM account, when they were very young, we used to call that the small account.
That's nice. Okay, the small account.
Small accounts are your ATM
account. Small return, small account. Okay, okay.
Because the interest is so small, it's always nil, you can't even feel it. Mm-hmm. And we explain to them that the reason for that is that they can easily take out their money. Just go to an ATM machine and you can already withdraw your money.
Right.
So the bank cannot really do anything much with your money. And they cannot give you a higher interest rate. Mm-hmm. However, the higher yielding instruments, we call them big accounts. They can give you bigger returns.
So bigger returns, and big accounts, very good.
Of course. And then the kid would ask, and why is that so? It's the same bank. And then we would say that it's because you cannot just take it out anytime, just like your small account. Mm-hmm. So you are giving the bank ample time to invest it, and the bank can earn from it and can share that earnings.
Right, right.
So that, I think that was quite clear to them.
That's great. You know, I have so many more questions for you, but we have to take a short break right now. Keep it here on The Money. We'll be right back. Still with us is Mary Rose Fres Fausto, who will answer some of the questions you sent to us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. And Melissa Hekule has those questions. Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hi, Rose.
Hi, Mel.
Such a great story. I love
more
it.
Questions, more questions.
I know. Well, our viewers actually have a lot of questions that are very relevant to your experience. So our first question is from Mark Reagan Garcia in Dumaguete. Mm-hmm. He asks, some parents talk to their children into lending them their savings with a promise of paying with high interest. Is this healthy for the child? Assume the parents are good debtors.
Well, what can I say, Mark? I'd like first to congratulate you because your children have savings account, but if I may ask, why are you borrowing money from your children? And if you're going to borrow and give them a high interest rate, what message are you giving to them? You might be giving a message that it's okay to incur a high debt cost. And why is that so? Are you desperate for money? So I'm not very comfortable with that. But I don't know if the intention really is to help the child earn.
Right.
And if that is the intention, I think there are other ways.
I agree. Maybe that is. This guy sounds like a good dad and he wants to do the Mark, right? So if he's a good dad, then you're saying there are other ways
there
to teach them how to make money, how to grow it, rather than being a lender.
Right. Yes, I was actually surprised with that.
Right.
Borrowing money from your kids at such a young age, probably not a good lesson.
I think
just
that is the underlying motivation, to teach them how to be able to make, right?
That's
how you can make money by being a lender.
Yes.
But you said there's other ways.
Okay, well, the next question, comes from Jane. She says, I am an OFW with two children who remain with their father in the Philippines. Whenever I come home, I feel so guilty that I buy them anything they want. I can't stop myself. Should I be worried? After all, we are only together for a short period of time every year.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that it's normal to feel guilty when you're always absent. I mean, if you're not there, the tendency of parents is to make up. And we usually make up with presents, spelled with an N-T-S. But you know what your children really need? They really need your presence with an N-C-E, your presence more than the presence that you can give them. But she's in a difficult situation, we have to understand, because she's an OFW. However, fortunately, there's a lot of technology that can be used. They can Skype probably on a daily basis.
Exactly.
So they would be updated with each other's goings on. And when she is around, maybe they should try to figure out what kind of activities they enjoy doing together, mm-hmm. aside from shopping. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's what they should really engage in.
Yeah. I like the presence is their present. No, their presence is their, it's a, such a homeschool moniker, how, you know, even if they don't have quantity time, the quality, right? Maybe that's
it. Yeah, exactly.
I think she's saying she's compensating by giving them presents when you're saying, hey, you know what, be there for them. When you do have the time, make it
That time that she spends with them should be quality time, not walking around the malls time.
Looking for presents, right?
Seriously. Exactly.
Just engage them, how are you doing, playing games, and you know, there's so many things they
can
do together.
Maybe she can teach them about why she is working overseas.
There you go.
And the purpose.
Yeah. If she cannot resist giving them a gift.
Stocks.
Stocks.
I knew you were going to say that. Yeah, there are.
Fast learner,
we have
Andrew.
A stock present
exactly.
for you. No, seriously,
it's a much better
gift. I really
gift.
Like that idea. Yeah.
It's a much better gift.
So if you will give any gift, maybe something that helps them earn. Ganda.
That's right.
Okay, well, we have another question. This is from Ramel. Mm-hmm. He says, my children come with me to the grocery. It's our bonding time, but I end up spending much more than my budget. How can I bring them with me and yet stay within my budget? Or should I just leave them at home?
Marketing terms that as
best
power.
Is that alone? This is a father?
Yeah, this is a father. Yeah.
He does that alone. But you know, it's grocery. You know, sometimes it's fun to have your children tag along.
Of course.
Yeah. What you should just do if it messes with your budget is that you have to involve them in the challenge. Tell them how much the budget is for this time's grocery. Mm-hmm. What you can do is actually give them a cart and tell them the things that they should
buy.
And usually, this should be the items that are relevant to them, like pambaon or what have you. But give them a budget and then a calculator, probably. Mm-hmm. So it becomes a game, diba?
And what you could do, actually, so if you give them their own shopping list, you can tell them, if you forego a few of these items, you can get something else you like.
That's right.
Or if you can find a cheaper but similar item, you can get something you like.
Yeah. Right? I think that's a good incentive.
And also teaching, I think maybe helping teach your children the value of no. In marketing, they call that pester power. And so they get a lot of campaigns so that the kids will pester and say, mommy, please, 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 please. And that's probably what happens to this guy.
That's very applicable.
So, no, you have to learn to say no. I mean, the children should learn to you know what, if mommy says no.
Yes. That's very applicable when you go to a toy store.
Yeah.
I remember those days. Whenever it would happen if we'd buy a gift for somebody. We would be attending a children's party.
Yeah.
And then I would say, today we're going to buy a gift for somebody else.
Right. Not for you.
For you,
it's not your day to day, kiddo. Right. And you get them involved. Like, oh, sige, I'll buy it for that person. Maybe that's a way to also do it with them.
Yeah.
So they're not thinking of themselves for that.
And you know, parents shouldn't always say, we don't have money for that. We don't have, you know, when our boys were very young, we never used that line. We don't have money for that. If they
would
like, we would tell them that I think it's too much. You know why? Because when we don't have money for that, it's the having or not having the money that makes
them
the
feel
decision.
Bad.
That's very good.
Yeah.
That's very
so you're not in control. So what happens to these kids when they grow up? Once they have the money, I'm going to buy that.
That makes
I'm
a lot of sense.
Sports car.
They feel depraved, no? Parang deprived.
Deprived.
So give the control to them. Wonderful. I have the money, but I'm not buying that.
It's not within the budget, or you know, it costs too much, right? Teach them frugality. Okay.
Okay. Well, we have another question. Raymond says, my two boys eat a lot, and I mean a lot. They like to eat takeout food, and I cannot bring myself to say no to their pleas for pizza. It's hurting my weekly budget. Any tips on how I can keep my food budget low and teach them how to be more frugal?
Well, I have three boys, and I can say my boys are skinny, they really eat a lot. And their friends who come over eat a lot too.
Oh, of course, they're friends. Yeah,
okay.
There's a lot of them.
His sons are really into fast food. I think you can use vanity as a tool here. You tell them that, you know, too much fast food is not good for the waistline.
Not good for your health, not good for the waistline.
That's right.
Not good for the waistline, the health.
That child.
And if they really love pizza, why don't you challenge them? Make your own pizza at home.
That's right. Get them interested. Yes. They can look online for a recipe. Okay, great. Actually, I wanted to ask you something. When you were teaching your kids about investing, how did you show them the results of what they were making? Would you do it on a weekly, monthly? basis, and I mean, how would you illustrate the way it grows and what it can do for them?
That's a very interesting question. You know what we did? And another weird thing about my sons is that they have their own balance sheets already since they were in grade school.
I want to hear this. Okay, yeah. Balance sheets in grade school.
Balance sheet in grade school.
Asset liability.
It may be very intimidating to some, especially those who don't have a very good memory of their accounting subject. But what really is a balance sheet? Balance sheet is just a picture of your assets, liabilities, and net worth. Asset is something you own, which is of value. Liabilities, that's your debt. And hopefully, by this time, wala pang debt. And net worth is assets.
May utang na sa kaklase, right? They borrowed.
Pwede.
Oh, sorry, sorry. Okay.
Assets minus liabilities, that's your net worth. So what I did, I started doing it when they were very young. I listed down the cash in bank, their stocks, their fixed investments, and I would update it on a quarterly basis. And then I realized they are very good with computers. They know how to work on Excel. So I transferred that to them. Right. And when they saw how much they got, it really thrilled them to bits.
Excellent.
So balance sheet. Balance sheet, I really advocate everybody to have
great
a balance
lesson.
Sheet. Because it's, you know, when you talk about saving and investing, it's essentially delaying gratification, right? Mm. So what do you do for the meantime? It's not very easy to delay gratification. Mm-hmm. And the balance sheet.
Yeah, balance sheet is a great way.
The balance sheet gives you the satisfaction already. So they would say, I'm not going to buy that gadget because I'm going to invest in.
Rules for grade school children, what is an asset? I mean, apart from the cash. Yeah.
Well, in the case of my sons, they have the fixed income and the stocks.
That early. Okay. Got it.
Okay. Thank you so much, Rose. That was very interesting, but we've run out of time.
Yeah.
Anyway, please send us your money questions via email, through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our Friday Q&A day.
Mel, Rose, start the children young.
Yes.
I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money.